Okay, fam, good morning. I'm excited to open up God's Word with you. I remember when I was still a high school youth worker, one of the ways in which we got kids to keep their mouth shut is you would just start praying, right? So the crowd would be rowdy and the room would be full, and then I would go, Lord Jesus, thank you so much for this beautiful afternoon. And then it would quiet down. Now, I'm not going to do that to you because you guys are not kids. But let's settle. Let's pray. Let's open up God's Word. Oh, Lord Jesus, we love your Word. It inspires us, it strengthens us, it builds us up, it convicts us, it enlightens us, it illuminates our minds. It's a lamp to our feet, it's sweet as honey as we taste it. We see you reveal yourself through your Word, Father God. We learn more of your character. We see you vividly, Lord Jesus, because you became a human being and you dwelt among us, Holy Spirit. We experience you in this time as close to us as our next breath. So when we open up your Word, we are expectant. We want to learn. We want to submit. We want to change. We want to glorify your name. So I pray now, Lord Jesus, as we do this, that all of these things would happen. I pray that you would give me the grace to preach faithfully this morning. I pray for our minds and hearts that might be racing about other things. Please give us a calmness now and a focus, and teach us how to use our words in your name. Amen. Amen. We're currently in a series, Living in God's World, God's Way. Series is a series in the book of Proverbs. Proverbs is wisdom literature, and to live in God's world, God's way, you need wisdom. It's more than knowledge, it's applied knowledge. It's when you not only know, but you actually do. It's when you obey what you receive. And we've been going through the book of Proverbs, looking at specific themes in the book of Proverbs. And here you go. Today's sermon will be about words. Words. Now, what does Jesus say about our words? Read it with me. Matthew 12, 36 to 37. I tell you, on the day of judgment, people will give account of every careless word they speak. For by your words you will be justified, and by your words you will be condemned. That's a strong start now, isn't it? Lower estimates say people speak 6,000 words a day. Higher estimates say people speak up to 16,000 words a day. Let me just put this one to bed. There is absolutely no proof that women speak more than men. It's a stereotype, it's a lie, it's an urban legend, it's not true. Point being, you are going to give account of a lot of words, according to Jesus. Now, the prideful, sinful you will go, yeah, but wait, Jesus doesn't understand. Jesus doesn't know. If Jesus knew what happened to me and what I felt and what I experienced, I mean, he will excuse my rash words now, won't he? No. Hebrews 4:15. We do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sin. Jesus knows. He's been through every single thing you have been through, are going through at the moment, and can ever go through, and he never sinned. He never sinned using his words. So if anyone says that you'll give account of your words, heed a man. Jesus did speak, though. What did other people say about his words? Look at John 6:65 to 69 with me. And he said, this is Jesus speaking, this is why I told you that no one can come to me unless it is granted him by the Father. After this, many of his disciples turned back and no longer walked with him. So Jesus said to the 12, do you want to go away as well? And Simon Peter answered him, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. Oh. And we have believed and have come to know you are the Holy One of God. Jesus spoke words of life. Jesus never sinned using his words. And Jesus said, we'll give account of every single word we speak. Well, what do? Do you never speak again? That's how I feel. I'm just going to zip it. Do you try harder? Do you say, look, from now onwards, I am going to be in the zone until someone cuts you off in traffic? Until you receive a text that only has a sharp emoji and not a smiley? Do you take stock at the end of each day to clarify all your wrong words and reflect on them? That's actually not a bad idea. But I promise you, you'll fail. Because you'll start with passion and then go, it's actually not that bad. Here's the answer. Here's what you do. You stay faithfully committed to the transformation of the Holy Spirit inside of you. You stay faithfully committed to the transformation of the Holy Spirit inside of you. Let's back up for a second. We say at Fellowship City that we have a discipleship journey. All of us are on this journey together. This journey is about loving God and loving people. How do we do that? We know God, we commit faithfully, and we give generously. How do we do that? We know God through His Word, through encountering Him, and through worship. We commit faithfully to transformation, God's people, and the mission of the church, and we give generously of our time, talents, and treasures. A disciple of Jesus Christ, look at it with me, commits faithfully to the transformation that the Holy Spirit brings in our lives. That's how you respond to the words that you will give account of every single word you speak. Why? Because that's the work of the Spirit inside of us. And that's great news, fam. We'll come back to the great news a little bit later. What I need you to know is that the Holy Spirit is currently, if you are a believer, working inside of you and creating you in the image of Christ. Transforming you, moving you from 1 to 2 and then from 2 to 3 and 3 to 4. Changing you, maturing you, bringing forth fruit in your life. It's the work of the Holy Spirit. It's not the work of you. And what we do is we submit to that work and we say, have your way in me. So we'll study what Proverbs says about words by answering the following questions. Here you go. Three of them. Why are my words so powerful? Second, how should I use my words? Third, where do I get the right words? We're going to seek wisdom. Now, words is the second most popular topic in the book of Proverbs. Proverbs only speaks about actual wisdom more than it speaks about words. And we have 90 references to our words in Proverbs. So I just want you to know we're not going to read 90 verses today, okay? So this is definitely not all there is to be said about our words, and I do want to put it to you that after today, you will be invited to study more, to seek more, and to learn more. The reason why wisdom literature speak about your words, listen closely, is because your words illustrate whether or not you are wise. If you want to know if someone's wise, listen to what they say. Now, side note, word and deed also go together, right? So if you want to know if someone is wise, look at what they say, listen to what they say, but also look at what they do. Because words always have corresponding deeds. Here's the truth. You can know Bible verses and still act a fool. You know if someone's wise when they actually put action to their words. Look at Proverbs 14:23 and Proverbs 26:7. In all toil there is profit, but mere talk tends only to poverty. All talk and no walk will lead to poverty. Proverbs 26:7, like a lame man's legs which hang useless, is a proverb in the mouth of fools. So the book makes it clear. It's not only talk, it's also walk. But I want to make it clear today that we're going to talk about talk. Are you with me? Let's look at the first one. Why are my words so powerful? Fam, using words is fundamental to our nature. We were created for relationship. Human beings use language. I know that you think that your dog can talk, but your dog can't because it's a dog. Human beings talk. We have language, many languages. Language is nuance and sophistication and meaning. We were made for relationship, and language is the vehicle in which we maintain this relationship. So we learn how to talk, and then we keep talking for the rest of our life. Now let me just take a quick side road here. I think we are in trouble with this. Because the challenge with technology, I want to put it to you, is that you can go through a whole day and actually not talk to anyone. As long as you are glued to your screen, you won't initiate conversation with anyone. You think that you are initiating conversation through this thing, but you're actually not. And the problem with us being addicted to our telephones is the more this happens, right, the more we do this and walk and scroll, the more disinterested we become in anything that is right in front of us. I promise you, if I walk off stage now and say, fam, I just need a quick bathroom break. You can do whatever you want. 70% of you will pull out your phones. 30% of you will go, hey, how's it, man? The problem with the 70 pulling out their phones is they become more and more disinterested in, hey, how's it? So we unlearn how to actually talk to someone. And not only that, let me put the nail in a little bit deeper, we become careless with our words because we communicate primarily on this. Have you ever heard the term a keyboard warrior? Someone that's really mean behind the keyboard. Oh, I will tell this to their face. And then you see their face and you go, no, I'm good, thank you. Yeah, no, lekker. That's a keyboard warrior. You're really brave when you type something. You'll never say it to someone's face. So we need to say stuff to people's face with real words and real language. Words can kill. Words can give life. Proverbs 18:21, death and life are in the power of the tongue, and those who love it will eat its fruits. Do you know that murder starts with a word? Suicide starts with a word. War starts with a word. A word is powerful. A judge speaks, someone goes to prison for the rest of their lives. John the Baptist gets his head chopped off because Herod spoke a word. Potiphar tells a lie, Joseph spends time in prison. Words can kill, you know. Words can also give life. Think of the amazing story in 2 Kings 5 as an example. Naaman has leprosy. He doesn't know what to do. A servant girl in the household speaks up and says, I know who can heal you. And he goes. And he gets healed. Naaman receives life by someone's words. Someone spoke up. And he was healed. Words can kill. Words can give life. Words are powerful. Words can hurt. Words can heal. Look at these three proverbs with me. 12:18. There is one whose rash words are like sword thrusts, but the tongue of the wise bring healing. Crazy, huh? Same tongue. And your tongue can either go into someone, that's a sword thrust. Or your tongue can heal someone. Your choice. 17:10. A rebuke goes deeper into a man of understanding than 100 blows into a fool. Words hurt more than fists. That's what it says. 12:25. Anxiety in a man's heart weighs him down. Oh, but a good word makes him glad. Fam, there's an emotional effect to our words, you know. And the images in these proverbs describe cutting words. Words that leave people wounded. Have you ever thought about the fact that we have the term emotional abuse? Verbal abuse. It's because it sometimes hurts more than physical abuse. Mocking someone. Naming someone. That stuff cuts deep. Cuts deep. What did your parents or your primary caretakers say to you that had a profound impact on you? Unfortunately, when I ask this question, many of you will remember cutting words and not healing words. For those of you that remember healing words, praise Jesus, you had great parents. You're just like your dad. You're going to get nowhere in life. Carry on like this and you'll see you'll end in ruin. God will sort you out. You're a real dummy. Why can't you just be like your sister? Stuff cuts deep now, doesn't it? Our words can also build up. Proverbs 12:25. Our words can encourage others. Our words can actually heal other people. A loving rebuke can actually also heal you, you know. A word out of your mouth can bring healing to someone else. Can I just put this to you? In South Africa, in 2024, do you know what's one of the most healing things you can say to someone? I am sorry. Just apologize. And own it. And ask for forgiveness. Say, I am sorry. I hurt you. I made a mistake. Use your words to heal others. That's how renewal and reconciliation happens, is if forgiveness is granted. Forgiveness can't be granted if you don't name the hurt. If you can't name the hurt if you don't tell the story. So open your mouth, and rather than cutting someone, heal someone. And if you made a bad, then that's how you do it. Look at Proverbs 16:27-28. A worthless man plots evil and his speech is like a scorching fire. A dishonest man spreads strife and a whisperer separates close friends. Why are our words so powerful? Because our words can divide people, you know. Do you know how you divide people? You gossip. Do you know what a whisperer does? It spreads stuff like fire. I'm telling you now that one of the main tools that Satan uses to undermine relationship is gossip, because no one ever checks it. I stand at the stage, I have a chat to Marie, it seems like a heated chat, and someone says to someone, jeez, looks like they are in kind of a bad spot now, isn't it? And then that someone says to someone else, did you see that they are in quite a bad spot? And then that someone says to someone else, well, I've heard that they're on a bad spot because it's about finance or family or something like that. No one came to us asking, are you guys in a bad spot? Because we choose gossip over truth. And that brings division. And the proverb says, it spreads like a fire. Have you ever seen a fire spread? It's devastating. And it destroys everything that comes in front of it. I'm serious about this one. Have you ever been in a group of Christians and it's time to share some prayer requests, and then in the prayer request someone gossips about someone else? We really need to pray for Roland and Tanika, you know. They are living in a devastating sin at the moment, you know. What I heard about them the other day is this, 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 and this. Let's pray for them. That's gossip. It's gossip and it divides people. It's subtle, but it's devastating. Let's confirm things before we share and speak about it. Here's how you kill gossip. You don't gossip. It's easy. Walk away. Not having any of this conversation? Cheers, take care, bye-bye now. That's how you do it. Because that's where the fire stops. Do you know why we gossip? Because we don't think it's a big deal. Nah, it's not that bad now, is it? I mean, killing someone. Hardcore. But I mean, it's just a little gossip. Do you know that gossip makes the lists of sins in the New Testament? Every single time the New Testament writer says, these things, do not do them. They are an abomination to the Lord. Gossip, right in there. So just sit with that one for a minute. We gossip because we love the feeling we get when we gossip. Because it puts someone else in a bad light and then I feel better about myself. Let's just be honest. That's why we gossip. It's so good for me to know that they are in a worse spot than I am. So let me just share the story. Fam, do you know that we love sin? That's why we do it. Sin gives us a feeling. And we love the feeling we get from sin, and that's why we keep doing it. Gossip is a sin. But you love the feeling that you get from it, so that's why you don't stop. We love negative information. If I would take my phone now and go, oh, wow, 15 of you will go, can I see? If I take my phone and go, oh my word, 80 of you will get up. Because we love negative information. It's part of the human sinful condition. Open up your News 24 feed. Start at the top, go down 20 articles and tell me how many positive articles you see. They do have something like Good News 24. But it's like 2 positive, 18 negative. Corruption, tenders, murder, blah, 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 blah. We love it. That's why we keep on sharing it, but we shouldn't. Look at Proverbs 26:20. Oh, I referenced this one wrong. My bad. It's supposed to be 20 and 22, okay? For lack of wood, the fire goes out. And where there's no whisperer, quarreling ceases. How do you put a fire out? Don't add wood. 22, the words of a whisperer are like delicious morsels. Oof, they go down into the inner parts of the body. Gossip is like chicken strips, fam. They are very tempting. Very tempting. But don't do it. You can also use your words to teach and instruct. 15:7. The lips of the wise spread knowledge, not so the heart of fools. 10:21. The lips of the righteous feed many, but fools die for lack of sense. 10:11. The mouth of the righteous is a fountain of life, but the mouth of the wicked conceals violence. Here's the truth, if you look at these proverbs. The wise person is worth listening to. Said in South African vernac, it's lekker to listen to a wise person. The righteous feeds people with their words. The wise person's words are like a fountain. Have you ever come to a fountain or a tap if you're really thirsty? And you go, gugunk, gugunk, gugunk. Oh, this is even better. Gugunk, gugunk. It starts going down your cheek all the way into your neck. Gugunk, gugunk. That refreshing feeling. Are you like that? When people speak to you, is that the feeling they get? What do you say when you have the opportunity to speak? You can also defend with your words. You can liberate with your words. Look at Proverbs 31, 8 to 9. Now, this is Lemuel speaking, by the way. It's not Solomon. And he's reciting an oracle that his mom taught him. He says we should use our influence for defense and liberation. Look at it. Open your mouth for the mute, for the rights of all who are destitute. Open your mouth. Judge righteously. Defend the rights of the poor and needy. Fam, we come from a country with a huge struggle history. And that struggle history is full of people who said, I am going to open my mouth for the things I see. This will no longer be this way. And I shall open my mouth for those who cannot speak. We should do the same, you know. I don't know how many of you watched the Bok game yesterday, But at the end of our captain, Siyamthanda Kolisi's interview, he said, "Ooh, I just want to say one more thing." Boom. And he leaned into 30 years of democracy, the oppression that still exists, and the fight for liberation. Love it. I was like, yeah, baby. Because he's a Christian. And he opened his mouth to defend and to liberate. You know, it's fascinating. Some Christians react to that going, "Oh, come on. Why can't he just be a rugby player? Why does he have to open his mouth now about politics and all of these things?" Because he's a Christian. And he's wise. And he's using his words to defend and to liberate. That's what influencers are supposed to do. Sadly, in this world we live in, people influence others and talk about things that have absolutely no relevance. Oi. We can advocate for stuff that doesn't actually defend or liberate anyone. I'm just saying. Don't waste your time. Think of Boaz in the Bible. Ruth comes. She gleans from the field. Do you guys know what Boaz says? "Ama gents, leave her alone." And the guys go, "Okay, the boss spoke. Let her have her way. Let her glean more than anyone else." He defended her with his words. Our country has social services, needs social services. I love the social work space, and I was involved with it a lot before we planted this church. Do you know what I often heard? One phone call saved a life. This kid was close to dying. And someone called and we saved them. Speak up. One phone call can save someone's life. There's a lot more to be said about this. I said earlier, there's more study to be done. But for now, this is why our words are so powerful. How should I use my words? Here we go. Number two. Proverbs 12:19, truthful lips endure forever, but a lying tongue is but for a moment. Be honest. Don't lie. Let's start there when we use our words. Why? Because fam, God, who is eternal, is also truth. God cannot lie. Did you know that? So when we speak the truth, we are reflecting the character of God. How cool is that? When we approach God and God speaks to us, He doesn't hide anything from us. And we never have to wonder if He's speaking the full truth. Which makes this relationship really safe and easy to enter into. Because He says what He says. And He means what He says. And He says what He means. When we speak truth to each other, we reflect that character. And we show people who God is. In truth telling, we build trust. Think about it. What happens to you when you find out someone lied to you? Fam, that's a hard one. Because lies break trust. This is a simple principle to use. Say what you mean, and mean what you say. Sometimes, even if it gets really personal. When Marie says to me, "What do I look like in this dress?" What do I say? Because I have to speak the truth. And if I lie, she knows it anyway, you know. So even in those situations, choosing truth over lies is better. Because if I tell her what I think, then she knows I'm not hiding anything from her. We have movies like Liar Liar, The Invention of Lying. Have you ever watched them? They're funny. Why? Because it shows how strange the world would be if everyone speaks the truth every second of every day. And then we laugh at it and then it hurts. Because we go, "Oh, it's actually so much better to speak the truth." So that's how we do it. Simple question to you. Do you speak the truth? How should we use our words? Be gentle. Be gentle with our words. 25:15. With patience, a ruler may be persuaded, and a soft tongue will break a bone. Hey, a soft tongue will be able to break down the hardest of hard resistance, which is a bone. Breakthrough will happen with soft words and patience. If you wash dishes and you're scrubbing away and it's not working, what do? You make it soft. And how do you do that? You just soak it first. Hey, hey, hey. Ooh, I love that. Casserole, hot water, put that bad boy down and go, I will see you in the morning. You're not going to win. I shall wear you out with patience. Because that water soaks and soaks and soaks. The next morning, just like the infomercials, in and out of the kitchen, just like that. Patience breaks down resistance. Jesus at the well in John 4. Do you know how he starts one of the most epic conversations he had? Can I please have some water? That's how he starts. Gentle. Approachable. Turns that lady's life around completely. If you've ever seen that scene in The Chosen, the TV series, her name is Fortuna in the series. She runs towards Sichar and goes, the best thing ever just happened to me. It's brilliant. What a scene. It started with, can I have some water, please? Gentle. Gentle. 1621. The wise of heart is called discerning, and sweetness of speech increase persuasiveness. My mom, I think personally, is a brilliant role model when it comes to this verse. My mom speaks sweet words. And she speaks words that are fitting for this situation. I learned that from her. As I was raised, my mom would go, dude, we're not going to talk about this year now. It's just not the right setting. Okay. Then we'll talk about it at a different time. And then when she talks about it, her words are sweet. Fam, listen to me. Shouting is the opposite of sweetness. Shouting yields zero benefit. It's a loss every single time. Honest, gentle. How should we use our words? Check this one. Wise and appropriate. Wise and appropriate. 25:11. A word fitly spoken, check this, is like apples of gold in a setting of silver. Ooh. Wise words, fitting words, are valuable. They're well crafted. They are molded into a pleasing form. If you want to do apples of gold in a setting of silver, you need skill. You need thought. And you need to do it in such a way that the golden apples will fit the setting. That's how wise people speak. You use your skill. You use your thought. You craft your words. And you put it in the right mold. Wise and appropriate. Look at 15:23. To make an apt answer is a joy to a man. And a word in season, how good it is. Fam, a good word, a word in season, an appropriate answer makes other people happy when they receive it. Do you make people happy with your words? Are your words wise? Are they appropriate? Okay, here comes the biggie. We should speak less. Not more. Oi, our words should be few. They shouldn't be many. Here's a whole selection of Proverbs for you. They might be a little bit small, but here we go. 10:19. When words are many, transgression is not lacking. But whoever restrains his lips is prudent. South African translation, your words will get you into trouble, period. 21:23, whoever keeps his mouth and his tongue keeps himself out of trouble. I'm not saying this is a joke. I mean this. If you are constantly in conflict with other people, check your mouth. That's a common denominator. If your whole life is full of struggle and strife with people and strained relationships, you might be talking too much. Just saying. 18:6, a fool's lips walk into a fight, and his mouth invites a beating. I've seen this many times. Back in the days when we were out on the bend, and you're in a bar setting somewhere, you just know the blabbermouth will get a beating later because he doesn't stop. He walks into the fight, his lips. It's a fascinating verse, isn't it? I think this is a verse for the day. Psalm 141:3. This is a psalm of David. And it's not actually a verse for the day, it's a verse for every day. Set a guard, O Lord, over my mouth. Keep watch over the door of my lips. It doesn't matter how triggered you are. It doesn't matter how hot your head is. Ask first that the Lord keep watch over the door of your lips before you speak. Okay, so we've said honest, not deceptive. We've spoken about gentle words. We've spoken about wise and appropriate words. We've spoken about few words, not many words. Last one, how should we use our words? Cool and not harsh. Look at these two proverbs. A hot-tempered man stirs up strife, but he who is slow to anger quiets contention. 17:27, whoever restrains his words has knowledge, and he who has a cool spirit is a man of understanding. Fam, head and heart. How do we use our words? Check this. Warm heart, cool head. What happens when your words create World War III? Is your heart grows cold and your head grows hot. The moment your nose turns red, stop. Because that's what a hot head is, you know. Your anger burns through your nose. Stop. Get the head cool and get the heart warm. In this conversation, I do not want to kill the other person. Let me just remind myself of that first. Warm heart. I actually love the other person. Struggling to love now, but I do. Okay, so let's get the heart nice and warm. Let's get the head nice and cool. Then you use your words. A cool head listens humbly. A cool head lets the other person finish their sentences. You know, in an argument goes into barking, and we keep on chipping each other in. That's when you've lost your humility and you're not keen to listen anymore. But if your head is cool, you will let the other person finish and actually listen to what they're saying. You allow time to think about it. Look at this one. Love this proverb, 18:17. The one who states his case first seems right, until the other comes and examines him. There are two sides to every story. And a wise person listens humbly first and then doesn't respond with, "What? Oh my word, I can't believe this." The wise person goes, "Let me think about this. I wonder what the other side of the story is before I rinse my mouth about someone." Because that's how it happens. Person A walks up to me and tells me about person B, and then I dish. Boom, boom, boom. I can't believe it. Such an idiot. Blah, blah, blah. Excuse me. Is that the only side to the story? The proverb says, the wise person knows that there is a different side to the story. So this might be the one who states their case first, but there's more to be said, and there's more to hear, and there's more to learn. Our words are powerful. We've seen how we should use our words. Let's do the last one. Where do I get the right words?
You study. You think. You seek. That's how you get it. Study meaning allowing something to enter your eyes, your brain, your ears, and your heart, looking for that wisdom, and actually thinking through what you're studying and what you're saying. Let me show you these three proverbs. Love them. 15:28. The heart of the righteous ponders how to answer, but the mouth of the wicked pours out evil things. What is the best way to answer now? Let me think about it. Proverbs says, that's what the righteous person does. Look at 16:23. The heart of the wise makes his speech judicious and adds persuasiveness to his lips. The wise person thinks about what they are going to say. The wise person prepares before they speak. Especially if you have to enter into a difficult conversation. Think about it. Prepare in advance. Ponder how you will answer. I learned this from John O'Tudhope. He's one of the pastors at Rooted Fellowship. He works with a 2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2 principle. He says, he looks at his telephone, a text pulls through, and something in him reacts. Then he puts his phone down for 2 minutes and just thinks before he responds. Because if he responds now, he's going to hurt someone. And if he hasn't had clarity in that 2 minutes, he goes 2 hours. And if he doesn't have clarity after 2 hours, he goes 2 days before he responds. Now, I understand if it's an instant message, you might have to respond before 2 days. But I loved seeing that from him. Instead of going, what were you thinking? Grr, 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 grr. He just puts it down for 2 minutes and goes, what just happened inside of me? Why have I received this text now and I get all of these feels? And then he would take up to 2 hours if he can't figure it out. What a fantastic response. That's wise. Look at this one, 35 and 6. I'm almost done. Every word of God proves true. He is a shield to those who take refuge in him. Do not add to his words, lest he rebuke you and you be found a liar. Do you know where you get the right words? In the word. Period. And it won't fail you. I want you to put this to the test. Think of a good day. A day filled with kingdom moments. A day filled with uplifting words. A day filled with encouraging words. And then see how much time you spent in the word in that day. And think of a poor day. Full of cutting words. Harsh words. Hot words. And think about how much time you spent in the Word. I promise you, you will find that the more you are in the Word, the more your words correspond with the Word, because the Word is the right source for our words. If I was a rapper, I would have rapped that one. But it's the truth. That's where we get it. So study, think, seek the Word. And then lastly, where do we get it? Right in here. Right words come from the right heart. Good words come from a good heart. And that's why we have to stay faithfully committed to the transformation that happens inside of us, because our transformation starts primarily with the transformation of our hearts. Look at the discipleship journey again. A disciple loves God and loves people by remaining faithfully committed to transformation. Jesus is after your heart, and he keeps on transforming your heart. And as he keeps on transforming your heart, from that heart flows the right words and good words. Look at it. 4:23. Keep your heart with all vigilance, for from it flow the springs of life. guard your heart. This is Jesus, Matthew 12, 34. You brood of vipers, he tells people who says we have extremely clean hearts. Jesus calls them a brood of vipers. And he says, how can you speak good when you are evil? For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. Fam, our tongue isn't actually the problem. Our hearts are. So how do you get a good, holy, awesome heart? Answer, by grace, through faith. That's how you get it. It's the work of the Holy Spirit inside of you. Check this. You can respond to this whole message and go, whew, I am nailing this. Don't do it because you're not. You can respond to this by saying, I am never going to speak a word again and I'm the worst person alive. Don't do that either. How you respond to a message like this is to say, I am a work in progress. Think about it, fam. Jesus died. He suffered as a substitute for our salvation. So I'm saved because He did it, not because I did anything. I just received the gift of faith. What we do is when we see the good news again, when we behold the cross, when we think about our salvation, we repent. That's what a work in progress does. I'm headed in this direction, and now I'm going to turn and walk back to God. That's what repentance is. And when we repent, we receive forgiveness. And when we receive forgiveness, we remember that it comes from the cross. That's the cycle of faith. Repent, receive, remember. Repent, receive, remember. All of us are in that cycle, which means all of us are work in progress. And our hope lies in the fact that Jesus is the ultimate example of how to use His words, and then He gives us the power to have our hearts transformed so that our hearts become good, so that the right words flow from our hearts. He gives us a word that we can study and think and ponder where we can get the right words, and then we see this transformation happening inside of us. Work in progress. Never completed, but definitely in progress. Are you guys with me? That's how we respond. Amen. Before we respond in song and before I do a prayer for us, I just want to say that if you think about these three answers, why are my words so powerful? How should I use my words, and where do I get the right words? You can be convicted in all three of these. Because firstly, you can be convicted that you shouldn't use your words to kill and to hurt and to cut. If that's your conviction today, then repent. And when you repent, you receive. And when you receive, you remember. Repentance is life-giving. You experience refreshment after repentance. It's not discipline, and then you have to work your way back. That's not how it works. Repentance brings refreshment. We spoke about how you should use your words. Maybe you are convicted that you should start using your words for something worthwhile, you know. That you should start using your words as a wise person. What's crazy is between the 6,000 and the 16,000 words we say every single day, almost 10,000 words are throwaway words. Words that actually don't mean anything to anyone or to you or to anyone else. We have so many words that we throw away each day. Maybe you are convicted today that you should start using your words as a wise person. Well, then open up your hands and ask Jesus to help you with it. We spoke about where we get the right words. Maybe you are convicted today about the fact that you just don't go to the source. And you never tend to your heart. So then you shouldn't be surprised that sewerage comes out of your mouth. Maybe that's your conviction. Wherever this landed, let me pray for you and then we'll respond in song.
Lord Jesus, our words are extremely powerful, and we want to use them to give life. We want to use them to heal others. We want to use them to teach. We want to use them to encourage and to build up. We want to use them ultimately, Lord Jesus, to glorify your name. And between all of our meaningful words and our throwaway words each day, Lord Jesus, it feels like we just miss the mark so many times. We either use our words to kill and to wound, or we use our words for nothing that is of any benefit to anyone. I want to pray, Lord Jesus, as we repent this morning, that we would receive your forgiveness and that we'll remember the good news. And that will bring a time of refreshing, a time of courage, a time of inspiration to us and to our lives and to our words. I pray, Lord Jesus, please draw us to your word. Help us to faithfully study, think, seek, reflect, and eat your word, the source of life. And keep on transforming our hearts, please, Lord Jesus, so that we can be more like you, that we can carry your character, and that good words will come from the spring of life. Help us to guard our hearts for your sake and for your glory. Amen.